The sharing and learning time was about preparing for a journey, and thinking about that during the week, I realized that the human race has been on a journey from the beginning. It was created by God, male and female, and it was created and situated in a good creation. God declared it all to be very good, and then something went wrong. And that's when the journey out of the garden began, and we've been traveling that journey ever since. And I tried to situate myself in that journey. I'm a participant, as are we all. History is moving forward, and it's carrying us along with us, with it. And I thought, in preparing for peace, that it might be helpful if I could reflect a little bit about my experience as what I call a child of the 60s. And many of you in this room were younger persons in the 60s, and you will remember some of the things that I'm going to indicate very, very briefly. I'd like to start, and I really appreciate that Phyllis began with a lyric from John Lennon. I'd like to start with a lyric from a man named Robert Zimmerman, also known as Bob Dylan. And what Mr. Dylan says, "Come gather around, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown. You'd better start swimming, or you'll sink like a stone, if your time to you is worth saving." And I choose that text because it resonates very, very nicely with what we see in the prophet Malachi and in the gospel reading that we had this morning. And I'd like to suggest to you that in every age of human experience, God sends the Spirit, and the Spirit moves through human hearts and human minds and creates language and creates actions which are either memorable or not. But mainly, I think, in the 60s, there was a movement of the Spirit which was suggesting that the life we had been building for ourselves after the Second World War, when economies in Canada, America, and in Europe began to prosper, we began to build a life that was basically built on the idea that material affluence was the key to happiness. And we believed that if we really worked and saved and invested ourselves, we could get all those good things that would make us feel secure and happy. Now, in the 60s, persons began to feel something inside of them, and they began to write poems and songs, such as the bit that I quoted from Mr. Bob Dylan, Mr. Robert Zimmerman. And I take it that the Spirit was moving in the 60s to suggest that something was not quite right and that there was a deep longing for things to be different. Now, I went through most of the 60s as a bystander. I spent most of my life as a bystander. I was an immigrant child, and I had lost my language on coming to Canada, and so I was a bit shy and reserved, and I was also very intent on trying to figure out what was going on around me. And this didn't change in the 60s. I wasn't really actively immersed in the whole, what we call the hippie movement, the movement which was saying, all we want is to give peace a chance. I watched. And by the time I was about 30, I realized that much of what we were doing in the 60s was optimism. It was not really hope yet. We were longing for something different, and we believed that if we would all just relax and chill and drop out, things would change. Well, they didn't change all that much. In fact, what happened was there were some enterprising souls higher up in the corporate world who realized that all this music, which was so attractive to a whole generation, could become a source of substantial income. And that's when the record industry really began to grow. And so all of the songs about peace and hope and change got transformed slowly but surely into material things. They were records that you could buy. They were songs that you could talk about to your friends. You could make an impression as you were perhaps trying to pick up some person to maybe be a life partner. But they did not sink in for most people in terms of what was the message of those songs. And I would like to suggest that the message of those songs was basically, folks, let's get ourselves in gear. Let's mobilize ourselves. Let's strengthen ourselves. But what we did instead is we began to settle back into the patterns that we had received in our family homes, patterns of coziness and comfort and convenience. And so most people gave up the ideals that were being expressed in the 60s, but some of us did not. And at the age of 30, I had reviewed my experience of the 60s, I had reviewed my experience with the language of the songs and the poems and such, and I had begun to think that it was wishful thinking that peace would just happen. And that's where these two texts come in for me. They are texts that are about refining. And if you folks know anything about the metal industry, you know that if you want to get gold out of its ore, you have to throw it into a fire. And so the extrapolation or the picture that we can draw from that, if we want our lives to become agents of peace in the world, we must also give ourselves over to being prepared and equipped to become instruments of peace. And that's a piece of work. Now, I'm somebody who's been doing that work since about my 30th year. At the age of 30, I decided to drop out in a really substantial way, in a way that the gospel calls baptism. That is to say, I had been baptized as a baby, and that's where I started my journey. But at the age of 30, I decided as an adult to make that baptism my own. I was going to commit myself to the promises that my parents and the church community had made when I was an infant. And what that baptism did for me is it began a process of discipline, daily discipline. And now at the age of 65, I've become aware that I've made some progress. Not a lot, but some progress. And I want to assure you that even a little progress along the way of life that leads to peace, even a little progress is worth a lot in spiritual terms. I now can feel quite comfortable speaking to a room full of people like yourselves, trusting that you're not going to get the great benefit from the language that I choose. I have a large repertoire of memories and stories that I can sort of pull out freely. But God showed me some years ago that the words were not the important thing. And what I'm beginning to discover is that the discipline, the practice of following in the way of God revealed in the gospel of Jesus, and you have to explore what those phrases mean, because the inherited meaning doesn't carry all that much water anymore. And there's a thirsty world out there. But what I discovered is that this is going to sound kind of interesting, I hadn't really let them go this direction, that at the age of 30, I lived most of my life wandering around Canada and up in the mountains alone and in the back alleys of cities and such things. At the age of 30, my life changed and I began this process of discipline. And one of the factors of that discipline was meeting Barbara, who I married at the age of 35. And some of you who are married will know that this is probably a good example of how it is that God does discipline us for lives of peace. And the image I've used, and I'm not just picking on Barbara here, that every wife can say the same thing about the husband she married, every husband can say the same thing. Each person who enters into an intimate, enduring relationship is going to be tested by that relationship. Because in such a relationship, the key thing is the difference of the two persons. I often speak to young couples who are planning to get married. I say, now when you two met each other, it's two persons. But behind each of you, there's a whole triangle of history going back generations and generations. And one day, your partner is going to do something and you're going to go, that's wrong. And that voice might not even be your own voice. It might be the voice of your grandma or grandpa or your great-grandma or great-grandpa. But something in you cannot quite accept something in your partner. And that's where the work of peace begins. It's a continuing process of being self-reflective, not assuming at the outset that I'm the one who's always right. And I want to say something about the Christian tradition for most of the Western world. In the Christian tradition, for most of our experience, the basic emphasis has been that no matter what the man says, that's the right thing. And the woman's place is to find her place. Well, that's been washed away as well. We're all persons now, and in our intimate relationships, we have opportunity to grow as persons. And I'm going to suggest to you that right now, in this period of history, we need to grow as persons who practice peace. It's the one thing that we can do to make a difference. The two readings that we had were about messengers sent from God. And God always sends messengers when human history gets into deep trouble. And those messengers say there's a way out of this trouble. And the messengers that we heard today suggest that the way out of the trouble of their time was to sanctify yourself, to make yourself clean, to make yourself pure, to get rid of everything that hinders you, and to gather in everything that helps you. And those of us who have been baptized began our life in the church by acknowledging that we were prepared to study, we were prepared to pray, we were prepared to do the works of righteousness, which are the good works of neighborly love. But in the Christian church, and in a particular way in our denomination, which is probably the one I'm best suited to speak about, some of those baptism promises were neglected. And I want you to know that if you neglected your mortgage in the way that some people neglect their baptism promises, you'd be homeless now. Banks will not tolerate you not honoring the commitment that you made. In the church, grace prevails. That is to say, nobody ought to be putting any pressure on anybody and say you're falling short of what's possible for you. But we do serve our hopes well, our hopes for peace, when we take seriously the message of the two voices we heard today. Really make a decision. Make a determination that you're going to start examining your experience in the world, and you're going to start separating things. And you're going to separate what is really not necessary at all, and you're going to leave it behind. And you're going to choose the things that are very necessary. And if I was to give an example, it wouldn't hurt to draw on Phyllis's little comments when she was speaking and the little comments that the children read off their cards. So much depends on how we stand in relationship with the young people among us. We may not get to the point where the earth is filled with peace, but we can get involved in such a way that the next generation and the generation to follow may inherit the consequence of our decisions and actions. That is to say, as one by one, we begin to decide to give ourselves to the work of peace, peace will begin to grow. And the example I have of that is a hot summer day on the prairie. It's cloudless. The sun is baking down on the earth, and wherever there's water, the water is being evaporated, drop by drop. And this is an invisible process, until a small cloud begins to form, and then you can see the water. And what happens is, with the process of evaporation, the cloud continues to grow and to grow until it gets saturated. And in the moment that it's saturated, it begins to release the drops of water again, and the drops of water fall on the earth as blessing, as rain, and that rain is what makes the crops grow. Right now in the earth, every time a person makes a decision to commit to the way of peace, it's like a little spiritual drop going up into the heavenly places. And that's a journey. Some days we're rising, some days we're falling, but generally by God's grace, we are rising up to form what the Bible calls a cloud of witnesses. So there's a person here, there's a person there, there's a person in Japan, there's a person in India, there's a person in Saudi Arabia, there's a person anywhere on the earth, a young person, an old person, a male person, a female person. It doesn't matter. Everywhere, persons are being drawn by the Spirit of God and making a commitment to the way of peace. And I encourage you to ask God to include you in that historical process. Ask that your heart be lifted up, that you begin to live in such a way that the emphasis is on the peace that you carry within you. There is so much that we can do externally. We can reach out to help people. We can reach out to encourage people. We can reach out to strengthen them. But the key thing to making a difference is the peace that you bear in your heart. Now, this is invisible to the eye, but it's very, very plain to the spirit. So that if you have spent years practicing peace, when you walk into the room, you bring that peace with you. So today, I am going to stand with Malachi, I'm going to stand with the gospel writer, and I am going to say, folks, things need to change. Things need to be different than they are, and whether we choose it or not, they will. Now, if we make a choice for the way of peace, the balance will tip towards peace. But if we make a choice to simply, what can I do? What can I make? How can I make a difference? If we shrug our shoulders and, well, there's another word, another little song that came to me from the 60s. Well, there's nothing you and I can do. You and I are only two. What's right and wrong is hard to say. Let's forget about it for today. We'll stick our heads into the sand and just pretend that all is grand and hope that everything turns out okay. That's not the option that I want to encourage you in. Whatever resources you have available to you in terms of time and energy and other things, I hope you will dedicate them towards making a difference and opening an opportunity for peace to be stirred up in somebody's heart who is desperately longing for it. All we are saying, John Lennon and Yoko Ono in Toronto, all we are saying is give peace a chance. Let peace be your priority. First here, and then everywhere. And may God give us each and all the grace to do this. Amen.